no here, but except Carlos and Celestin. So I just have to say, basically, idea for this workshop is that Celestin is from School of Pharmacy. Dr. Young is from School of Pharmacy, and Carlos is expert in mathematical modeling, and so we have actually from extreme far side to extreme other side, actually. So, and we are in between. So main idea is he's going to present his problems, and we found the project, and help with the help of Carlos, and so how we can solve that problem. This is the idea, mainly from a discussion kind of this workshop. But compared to previous two workshops, this one we have made slightly change, because previously we just started workshop right there. But this one, at least we have already worked 2 months, so we do have some kind of preliminary results to show. So that's why some of the students, Munshur and Fatima, they are going to show some of the things, and from there we go, we discuss them, then we decide how to go from there, what are the other projects, and we all work together. Okay. So let me introduce Dr. B.C. Yon. He's from School of Pharmacy at UMKC, and he will be talking about Zika virus. Actually, he is the person who makes the thing that can control the virus. Let's see, we'll be able to make it and make a lot of money. Okay. Let's
I really appreciate this opportunity to be talking to colleagues in the math department. So we are in pharmacy school, and there is a more and more interest about interdisciplinary. So this is a wonderful opportunity. And this morning, as earlier when I was listening to Dr. Chavez, I really learned about how math can be used. So it's really a good start for us to start thinking about how we could, in the case of one disease here, how we could work together. So I'm not an expert in Zika by any means. It's a new disease. So what I did right now, just as a base, because we had the discussion a few months ago, and then we were looking at my topic, and I threw out the word Zika because I heard in the news, and I'm a member of the AAPS, American Association of Pharmaceutical Scientists, and I'm a member of the chair of one group there called AAPS Pharmaceutical Global, so Global Pharmaceutical Focus group. So as a chair, so that when they heard about Zika, they emailed me and said, your focus group should do something about in a newsletter or in the AAPS blog, which is a national organization, international, about pharmaceutical scientists. So we wrote something. I will mention a few slides about what we wrote, just to inform pharmaceutical scientists about this emerging disease. So that's why I mentioned to my colleague last night, we were looking at brainstorming about different diseases. Topic of interest or modeling, I said maybe this is a hot one. Indeed, this is a very hot one. So it will be a very broad, general information. I will disappoint you folks in the math. There is no equation. No equation whatsoever.
Okay.
So then I like talking with math, folks in the math department. Because when I was in high school back in the Ivory Coast, I was in Somalia, Africa, I was thinking about going to in high school, math, of course, I was pretty good in math and healthcare or finally, I leaned toward pharmaceutical pharmacy field and pharmaceutical research. But I still have in my back of my mind, wow, I should have been doing math. So this is an opportunity to tap into math brain to do something together. So, and also, as we do our research, I always feel like some rationale is missing. And math people can really help. So, again, as I mentioned to one of your colleagues here, people sometimes think maths and health are different, and the speaker, our speaker just earlier really made a point. It's health. Everybody is sick, there are problems to solve, and sometimes mathematicians are doing their little equation whether the best way to really use your time and life and brain power, one way could be to apply to healthcare. So, the case of Zika, and what I'm going to talk about is some general background about what this virus about, how it transmitted, and how can we prevent this disease, or what are the treatment options today. And then toward the end, I will mention some opportunity maybe for modeling, so broadly, so that just the first step for us to start brainstorming further on this. So the virus basically is transmitted by an insect, like in the case of malaria, so mosquito bites you, bites another person. So that's the way. So it has been discovered some years ago, 1947 actually. So it's not a new discovery of Africa. People knew that since in Africa. And again, Africa gave a lot of things to humanity. There are a lot of bad things too. Most of the diseases like Ebola, they only generate there, right? So that's what's happened when you have been around for a long time. So Africa in 1947 was in Uganda, 1952, they find the first time in human in Uganda and Tanzania. In 2007, then there was some outbreak in the Pacific area, and then it has been moving forward globally slowly. So actually, this slide shows you where it started. And you see the 1947, and in French Polynesia, 2007, and then later on, you see recently the one that really broke the big movement is in Brazil. Brazil in 2000 last year, actually, and the reason why people got a lot of sensation about the tremendous number of babies born with a lot of rape, so called microcephaly. So, and then basically this slide shows you how the disease is infecting people. So you start here, mosquito bite you, and then you're infected, and then another mosquito bite, another person infected, and bite another one that's not infected, and so forth. So that's the way. It's kind of moving the loop. So this slide shows you basically some of the symptoms that you have when you have, you know, you can have a glimpse of the virus infection if you have these symptoms here, like fever, rash, joint pain, and so forth, but which are also symptoms that you find in other diseases. Right? Yellow fever can give you that too, but it's not enough. So usually, more precise tests identifying the RNA, the PCR can be to find out exactly what's the molecule that related to the virus. But the fever already, if you come from the area where it's known that you have the virus, if you come from a trip and you have any kind of symptom, then you know that you have. And again, this depicts a little bit how the transmission occurs. And from the mother that infected, it's now speculated that microcephalia can be due to the transmission through the placenta. So this is some of the symptoms I mentioned earlier. So you get fever, rash, and it looks like this. You see this nice lady have this bad infection. Then this shows you some of what it means for microcephaly. You see the baby's head is not fully formed, and it's really heavy, and you cannot imagine the impact of this that baby's life, economic impact. Imagine we have an old baby born like this, so how it affects the world. So that's kind of the drama about this disease. So, but when you look at here, the statistic, there are about 25,000 children in the U.S. based on data out there that born like this. And our speaker mentioned earlier, there are many other diseases that can do that. Measles is one of them, but the beauty, for example, is because we have vaccine. Some of them are genetic disease that affect the chromosome. Down syndrome is one of such diseases. So there are many other diseases, but in this case, it can be transmitted. So that means if you don't do anything, exponentially, maybe, we just sat down and don't do anything, then if the next generation of humans is like this, right? It looks like we're on Mars, so that's a bit scary. So that's maybe the reason why people start having a lot of concern. And so this slide shows you some of the other diseases. I just picked this up on Mayo Clinic's website, which is a major number one hospital in the U.S. They have this slide about all the diseases that can create microcephaly. And then you see. So even when substances like this are alcohol, and if the lady's pregnant and take a lot of alcohol and use some drugs, they can have baby like that too. So there are many other, or if you are not well fed when you have pregnancy also. And then this slide shows basically that there are many other diseases that can lead to this kind of problem. And if we focus on infectious disease, you see toxoplasma, German measles, and chicken pox, all these are well-known diseases that can, if not well controlled, can lead to this kind of problem. Now, how do we diagnose this disease? Obviously, the symptom I mentioned, if somebody traveled and comes from an area like Brazil these days, and, or some of these areas that are well-known to have the infection and have the rash and pain, joint pain, it's fever, some of you mentioned that, it's already suspicion that the person has the disease. So, but ultimately, as I mentioned, PCR technology to identify the RNA molecule, which is in the blood of the, or body fluid, would be very critical to make sure that we have the virus. Now, how do we prevent the disease? There are different strategies out there. Since we know that mosquito bite somebody and bites off, obviously the first thing is, like for malaria, we can protect from host, as the, our previous speaker mentioned, host interaction with the virus or the vector. So that means we can use maybe like some insect repellent to repel. And there are some chemical out there, and the World Health Organization website gave some specific chemical that could be used that have been proven to kill these vectors. And then also we can use some physical barrier. If you live in the area, if you could close all these windows and so forth, that will prevent you from having from any bite. For example, in Africa, when I was growing up, you can also have some nest. Little nets that you can sleep in around yourself. People camping also do that. So these all these can prevent you from being. It has been known that notice our water containers in a region like this, so they can attract the mosquitoes. So you want to make sure that you don't have anything that have water, like flower pot and things like this, that could attract the mosquitoes. So any all these are interesting measure one could take. To avoid, especially if you are traveling in an area like that. So it's important to know in general. Now, how do we treat this particular disease? It's a new virus, new problem, no clear treatment, even no vaccine so far. So, like many other diseases in pharmacy, in healthcare in general, you have seen, have a rest, if it becomes worse, talk to your doctor. So that's it sounds like a lawyer speaking to you. So talk to your lawyer, talk to your doctor. So these are some of the strategies that one could take in general to solve the problem. We could control the vector, because we know that this Aedes aegypti is a vector. It's actually the same vector that has been shown to be involved in yellow fever, dengue transport around and contamination. So if we can control that, that would be very interesting. We can also control the disease surveillance, have active surveillance of the disease. And that's where, again, in another area where modeling data could help. And then area that has this, they should have like even for the earthquake, in San Francisco, I traveled there, and the other area where they always prepare just in case of earthquake. So same thing, disease preparedness, people should be prepared in those areas. Even the area that far away should be prepared just in case you have a surprise. So training people is also important. See, this kind of talk, maybe in the area where we have a disease, people should be trained even further about how prevent disease. Sometimes people are not aware of that. Vector control research. So we need to do more research. As a matter of interesting research, recently the genetic has been used to modify these vectors so that when they release that vector out, that mosquito that has been genetically modified, and when it goes out, it mates with another mosquito naturally, then the upstream just collapse, die, revolt, even before becoming adult. So which is interesting. So this is one way research already is potentially going to help. So that's a vector. But besides vector control, we have also potential to develop new vaccine. We have new vaccine to immunize people so that when they have these new infection, then the infection doesn't make progress in the body. So these are all interesting opportunities. Now, this leads us to what are the opportunities out there to develop new drugs or vaccines in this field? So there are a lot of opportunity, and again, a lot of unknown. And recently, NIH, and I read in the news recently even that Obama and others, the politicians, they are even struggling to have more, some of the money dedicated to Ebola before they want even to switch to Zika research. So it's, that's why we, this is really timely for us to talk about this. A lot of things that come out. And as we start working on this together, maybe we have more preliminary data that position us to even do more be competitive on some of these research. So for development, one should understand if research allows, if there are basic research to understand the life cycle of how the virus progress and divide, you know, then even then, what are the different serotypes? So ideally, the future drugs or vaccines should aim at different serotypes, which means sometimes you have different biomarkers. So can we target these different biomarkers? And then if there is a new system, can we attack primary or secondary disease type of infection? And then if there is such a system also, again, these are ideal, better oral. We know in pharmacy that everybody likes things in their mouth. When you have to be injected, then you don't want to do that many times, right? It's painful sometimes, right? So a lot of kids know that when they have to do vaccine, when they see the hospital, oh no, I don't want to go there again. So it's very painful. So oral delivery is always best. So, and things that are stable, so that in a poor country, like tropical, this disease developed in tropical areas, so that the heat stable, people don't need to think all about refrigeration, which is not cost effective for many poor families. Here we take it for granted, but in the poor world, I was growing up in Africa, in an area where people don't have refrigerators. Many people don't have, that's lifestyle there. So then forget about keeping your drug in the refrigerator and things like that. So you want something that very stable, that has a long shelf life, ideally. Also, as we are in a poor country, and many people don't want to waste money on drugs anyway, so it should be low cost too, right? So if it's low cost, even better. And then we need a research site to explore different cellular targets. That's called for people in the immunology field, in virus, infectious disease areas, so if they can look at what are the different targets there? There are a lot of unknowns so far. When the virus gets in, what are different cellular targets, how you make progress in the body? And then if there is such as things, it should be good in infant, children, and adults too, right? Especially even baby, can we prevent the baby also from getting anything like that? So these are philosophical, some of the things that potentially we should be considering drug development. In terms of implementation, so ideally, again, we need like a point of care diagnosis, right? So if somebody comes, we're in the hospital, we can diagnose right there in a cheap manner and take the appropriate action. That would be also interesting. And if there is and like many infectious diseases, potential like HIV, we know when we give one drug for many times, that's why in HIV treatment today, we have to give three drugs called like Truvada, if you've heard about Truvada, so three drugs together. And this is known because, again, the opportunity for mathematical modeling there. So it's known that resistance is another problem. If you give one thing, the virus becomes smart and change and mutate, now fight that disease. You give the drug, doesn't work. So then we have probably to give several cocktails in the future, right? So in this case too. And then we have the clinical study to prove all these evidence. So these are all, again, philosophical, based on what we know from other diseases. Now I reached a slide where I think we should talk about opportunity for mathematic modeling. Right? So I see basically roughly three goals of opportunity for modeling. One is the disease out there, as our previous speaker mentioned, Dr. Chavez mentioned. So you can model the disease expansion in the world. That's one area. Right? So, and the goal is to understand how to control the dissemination rate or whatever, right? What are the factors, temperature, moisture, environmental, behavioral factors, all these that can help control, right? Then, is needle involved, for example? Needle, giving needle, not giving needle. So these kind of things, right? Or even we're talking about blood, because this is involved blood. Is blood transfusible? So a lot of factors. So this is basically out there modeling. Okay, that's I call goal one. To control disease transmission, looking at reservoirs, okay. And the goal two, I call that the organism level. So which means if I take one human being, right? So how the disease progress in that human being. From the time that the mosquito bite to taking all his body over. So that could be interesting too. And then we can talk about the specific game. It's new, I don't know. So we look at brainstorm together, what are the things, where the factor, the parameter that we need. So the third level would be, now that we understand all these, or maybe that should be the first, actually. Right? So how do we, what measure vaccine drugs to be efficacious to stop the disease or to prevent the disease? So this could be another area. So what are the factors that affect treatment of vaccine effectiveness? Safety and so forth. Safety and efficacy in general. So the problem of perhaps this will include a lot of factors like understanding the type of drugs that we need. Because in pharmacy, we know we have a different type of drugs, right? Different class. We have small molecule drugs, we have big molecule drugs, right? Macromolecule, right? Biologics. And even if we select one drug or one class of drug, what are the physical chemical properties of the drug that affect, or vaccine that affect efficacy? And if we have one drug, and we know the physical chemical property, we also, in pharmacy, we know we have different formulation. See? What are the type of formulation that affect efficacy? For example, because it's a technical word that we use in the field, formulation means it could be, dosage form could be tablet, ointment, suppository, liquid, powder, inhalation, right? So, or it could be applied to the skin, topical. So for one chemical that kills a virus, it could be presented in a different type of formulation. Which one works better? Mathematic model might help, right? So then, now, assuming you use one formulation going in the body, what we call PKPD, pharmacokinetic pharmacodynamic, pharmacokinetic roughly how the drugs behave in the body. Pharmacodynamic, how the body behaves on the drug. So the drug has a motion. Some parameter we usually get there when we're doing PK is like drug half-life, Cmax, area under the curve. So all these are quantitative, the extent of drug in the body, the duration of the drug, the elimination rates, and so forth. So all these involve some mathematics. So, and then the pharmacodynamics most of the action on some receptor or the virus level, decreasing something like that. So basically, from the school of pharmacy perspective, these are things that we have hands on, right? So all the things I'm talking about involve maybe epidemiology, medical school, perhaps if you are doing modeling that, it doesn't have to be limited, you may want to talk to medical doctor there, somebody doing epidemiology
the spread of some virus. So we are not doing that specifically. So we are.
But when we were talking last night, what I was trying to put my hands on here, if it is in this whole tree area, right, from the school of right now, then we can, I can do something about it based on what we have going on. And as a matter of fact, when you head and we're talking about that virus and we say, oh, maybe it looks like Ebola, then who wants to play with that, right? Then I check with the safety people in our school here, in our institution, the biosafety people. They say, actually, there is a Zika virus is safe. Like, there are already some modifications people are doing for research. So there is a mundane version there that one could buy that's acceptable in our cell culture facility here, that one could play with, at least as a modeling, to see how it divides, what thing can we put on so that we stop the spreading, right? So things like that, I think, might be feasible in our hands right now, on the next few months or something. And we have expertise and background to do that, cell culture facility and so forth. So that's kind of in conclusion. So basically, from a lot of modeling and from Dr. Chavez's work, also many other work on modeling in different disease, we can learn already from that, right? Ebola, malaria, other HIV, a lot of modeling work out there. I even didn't know gonorrhea was modeled too, right? Whoa, people have been thinking about this. And again, suggesting, and I see a lot of folks here from undergraduate, they are doing maths, intensive maths, and they are thinking, I don't really know what to do with that. Man, you guys have a lot to eat. If you are sick one day, so think about who is helping to treat your disease. Your mind brain can tap into and kind of provide rational solution to do these things. So we can learn from others to do that. And clearly there is a sense of urgency from the effect that I show you. And that's why government and everybody is saying, whoa, we need to do something about it before we notice every baby being born like that. And then, so therefore there is a great time for us to talk about, there is a critical need to do something about, especially with the microcephaly. So these are some of the references I used earlier. Again, this was because Dr. Nabin asked me to do something about the background, and so I went to look at different websites, and actually our AAPS blog was on this website. There's one thing that blog. And then so I also wrote we have something called AAPS Global Newsletter, so it's something that's got to. And then I saw that President Obama won $2 billion in emerging aid to combat Zika. Wow, that's a lot, right? So if we can get a little bit here at UMKC after this talk. That's good, right? Something to think about. And Science Magazine mentioned that the same level, that was the source of. And recently, after that, I saw also that they were saying that they also want to take from Ebola fund. So, which means it's really timely we are talking about this, and we should come up with some interesting direction after this workshop, hopefully. And hopefully this discussion will motivate some of you, especially undergrad, that they have all these great math skills and they think like, I don't know what to do with it, right? So mathematicians are some of the smartest people on earth, right? Like lawyers. So they should use some of the capacity to apply to healthcare, because all of us become sick at one point. And math play a lot of role in helping rationalize. So, this being said, this is the end of my presentation. The paper is open for discussion.
Okay.